Hello children, are you enjoying these holidays? Are you eager to come to school? Yeah, because of certain circumstances you are unable to come to school. But here we are bringing the digital classes to your home and you should follow them. I am Sunandani Chaggam, SA Bioscience, GHS, Burkam College. Now take out a book and pen and write down the important points which I tell in this lesson. And our district is Bhadradri Khammam district. It has many factories. And in Bhadrachalam we have a paper factory. Along with paper, it produces a lot of waste material. And this waste material is to be sent out of the factory. Our home also produces a lot of waste material, and this domestic waste must be sent out through the sewage. Our body is a living cellular factory. It also produces waste material in regular intervals of time. This waste material must be eliminated out from the body in regular intervals. What are these waste and how are these wastes produced and how are they eliminated out from the body? This is the concept we are learning today, and that is excretion. Excretion part 1 lesson is we are learning today. And here the living organisms require energy either for survival, that is build up of their bodily proteins, and this process is called anabolism. They also need energy to perform certain activities which is obtained by breakup of the glucose molecules, example in respiration. This process is called catabolism. This catabolism and anabolism are together called as metabolic activities or metabolism. And in these metabolic activities, and they produce in metabolic activities, they produce certain wastes and also the required products. Here are the metabolic processes, examples given: photosynthesis, it produces glucose, oxygen and water. Respiration produces carbon dioxide, water vapor and energy. Digestion produces glucose, amino acids, fatty acids and glycerol. These are the products of certain metabolic activities. So here you see carbon dioxide is not necessary for us, and also excess of water is produced. Along with these, nitrogenous waste products are also produced and they must be eliminated from our body. Here these metabolic activities, if they are not removed from our body, if they are not removed from our body, they causes toxicity to our body, and they are poisonous and must be separated from the blood and removed. And these nitrogenous products are eliminated by the excretory system. And excretory system eliminates the waste products. In Latin, ex means out, crinere means shift. So excretion is removal of wastes from the body. Here they include, as I told earlier, carbon dioxide, nitrogenous compounds like ammonia, urea, uric acid, bile pigments, excess salts, etc. If they are present in excess in the blood, the ionic balance is disturbed. Maintenance of ionic balance in the blood is called homeostasis. It is called homeostasis. If it is disturbed, it causes poison to the body. So this is maintained by kidneys. This is maintained by kidneys. And you may get one mark questions like, what happens if the nitrogenous products are not removed from the body, and what is homeostasis? They may come as one mark questions. Now let us see what are the components of the blood and urine, and what is the normal range of these ions in the blood and urine. To test this, we have to take 24 hours urine of the patient, and in that only 100 to 150 ml of the sample is taken to test the contents of the blood and urine. Here you see these are the components of the blood of the patient, and here this is the normal range of the components. These are the units in which these components are measured, that is milligrams per deciliter and millimoles per liter. This is for the first component is glucose and fasting. Normal range is 60 to 100 and in the patient it is 82. Sodium normal range 135 to 145. It is 137 in patient. Potassium 3.5 to 5. Result 4.10. Chlorides 95 to 106. Result is 101. So normal. Urea 15 to 40. It is 29 in patient. So it is also normal. Creatinine should be 0.6 to 1.5 in range. It is 2.8. So it is beyond the normal range. And uric acid must be 3 to 5 in normal range. It is 7.5. It is also above the normal. Total cholesterol should be 150 to 200. A result is 221, so it is also above the normal range. Triglycerides 60 to 200, it is 167, normal. Calcium 8 to 10.5 and it is 9.4, it is normal. Phosphorus 3 to 4.5, it is 4.5 normal. Bilirubin, these are the pigments in the liver, it should be 0.1 to 0.8, it is 0.7 normal. Total proteins must be around 6 to 7.5, it is 7.2 normal. Albumin 3 to 4 and it is 4.6. This is also in the normal range. It should be, albumin should be 3.0 to 5, it is 4.6, so it is also normal. So in this table, creatinine, uric acid and total cholesterol are above the normal range, that is the plasma, serum and blood of the patient contains more amount of creatinine, uric acid and cholesterol. Now let us see the urine test report of the patient. Here urine test report, the analysis says here these are the components of the urine which are tested, and here 24 hours protein, the normal range should be less than 100 grams, it is 90 milligrams per day, normal. And creatinine should be around 1 to 2, here it is 2.7, above the normal range. Calcium up to 200, it is 305. This is also above the normal range. And phosphorus up to 1 gram, it is 0.8 normal. Uric acid up to 600, it is above the normal range, that is 800 micrograms per day. Now on electrolysis, the sodium content should be around 125 to 250, it is 140. Potassium 25 to 100, it is 50 millimoles per liter. Osmolality, it is around 100 to 600, but the patient has 180, it is also normal. Glucose 50 to 80, it is in the patient 65, so it is also normal. Chlorides 120 to 130, in the patient they are 128, normal. Urea, it should be around 20 to 30 grams per day, but it is 35. So in this table we can see that creatinine, calcium, uric acid and urea are beyond the normal range. So in these tables will be given for you in the examination, and they may put questions like what are the components of the blood and urine which are above the normal range. So you have to analyze the data and write the components which are above the normal range. So here we can see that the patient has certain things which are above the normal range in the blood and urine. Then how are they removed from the blood? Which components will, which organs of human beings will remove? Yes, the kidneys. Excretory system in human beings is given in your class, and this is the kidney of goat. You go to a butcher shop and take a kidney, buy a kidney, and we can take the section cutting. It appears like this. It is LS of the kidney of a goat. You can see the outer side is somewhat reddish brown in color. This is the dark portion. We shall read this after this topic. Now this is the excretory system of human beings. You are learning from your lower classes. There are a pair of kidneys which are bean shaped and reddish brown in color, placed on the dorsal side, on either side of the vertebral column, and the outer side of the kidneys are convex shaped and inner side is concave shaped, and there is a notch on the inner side, that is on the concave side of the kidneys, and a pair of ureters and urinary bladder, urethra. These are the parts of excretory system. Each kidney is 10 centimeters in length, 4 to 5 centimeters in width, and 4 centimeters in its thickness. And towards the concave side of the kidneys, we can see the renal artery entering in through the hilus, renal vein, and the ureter coming out of the hilus. And renal artery carries oxygenated blood into the kidney. Renal vein carries deoxygenated blood out of the kidney. So you learn the diagram and also parts of the excretory system in human beings. You may get for 2 marks question. Now let us see the longitudinal section of the kidney. I have shown you earlier the goat's kidney LS. This is also the LS of the kidney, or the internal structure of the kidney. You see here, yes, this is the outer region, cortex, which is dark somewhat lighter. This is the medulla region, and here you can see the pyramid shaped structures called calyces, and these are the lines. These lines are the nephrons. Nephrons, these are the functional and structural units of the kidney. These are like small filters, you know, T filters. These nephrons are the small filters which filter our blood, and waste material will be removed from the blood by these nephrons. So these are here, they are present in the pyramid like calyces, and these are the structural and functional units. You see, this is the pelvis region where all the urine is collected, which is produced from the nephrons. You can see here, this is the renal artery, and this is the renal vein, and this is the ureter, and the ureter will arise from the hilus region. This is the hilum, and from here it starts and ends into the urinary bladder. Now this is the internal structure of the kidney. Here we can see these ureter are a pair which are at least 30 centimeters in length, muscular, and also the urine passes from hilus region, that is from the pelvis region, through these urinary tubules with peristaltic movement. Through peristaltic movement, it enters into the urinary bladder. In the bladder, the urine is stored, and it can store up to 800 to 300 to 800 milliliters of urine. Urinary bladder is a pear-shaped structure, and it is a distensible sac. It can extend and contract. It's a sac, and it is present in the pelvis region. This is the urethra. Urethra is the opening of the excretory system. It helps in passage of urine outside. In between the urinary bladder and the urethra, there is a ring of sphincter muscles which help in passage of urine. Urethra is about 4 centimeters in length in females. It opens into vestibule. In males, it is 20 centimeters in length, and it is a common urinogenital tube. Now let us see the internal, the structure of nephron. I told you earlier, the nephrons are present in the pelvis. Nephrons are present in the calyces region. Here you can see the nephron. These are the filters, small filters. Here, nephron consists of two parts. One is the Malpighian body and the renal tubule. Malpighian body consists of a cup-shaped Bowman's capsule. Malpighian body consists of cup-shaped Bowman's capsule and glomerular region. This glomerulus is formed by a network of capillaries. One is the renal artery enters here, and this arteriole forms a network of capillaries. As a efferent arteriole, it enters into the Bowman's capsule. This efferent arteriole's diameter, thickness is more, and it emerges out as the efferent arteriole. The thickness of efferent arteriole is more than the efferent arteriole. Here it forms a network of blood capillaries, so it is called as a glomerulus. And the difference in the diameter helps in creation of a pressure inside the glomerulus or the arterioles, which helps to filter off the waste materials, into the Bowman's capsule. The Bowman's capsule is lined by podocytes, which have small pores to help the process of filtration. This filtrate enters into the next part of the nephron, which is called as the renal tubule. And this renal tubular part consists of proximal, which is nearer, it is called proximal convoluted tubule, which is distant, it is called distant convoluted tubule. And this is the loop of Henle. These are the three parts of the renal tubule. From here, the urine that is formed in the Bowman's capsule enters into the convoluted tubule, proximal convoluted tubule. It is called as the primary urine. Now, we can see the detailed structure in this diagram. This is the efferent arteriole, this is glomerulus, efferent arteriole, proximal convoluted tubule, distal convoluted tubule, Henle's loop, and this is the collecting tubule. The collecting tubules of the nephrons will open into the pelvis, where the urine is collected. From pelvis, they enter into the ureter. So you learn this diagram, it may come from a 2 marks question. So with this, we have learnt the structure of the excretory system of our body. And you learn all the 1 mark questions which I have mentioned, and diagrams. We can see the process of excretion in next part, that is excretion part 2. Thank you, children.